Welcome to St. John's Lutheran Church in Springfield, Ohio. Today is May 27th, 2018. This is Memorial Day and the Holy Trinity. Our pastor is the Reverend John H. Pollock. Our organist is Greg Nolte. Our 8 o'clock service this morning was at the Melody Cruise Drive-In east of Springfield on Route 40. Our drive-in service goes from Memorial Day weekend and through Labor Day weekend. The flowers on the chancel stands are to the glory of God from Sister Sally and Martha Burke in memory of their parents, Captain Billy and Gladys Burke. St. John's Outreach Store is open Monday through Friday, 9:30 to 1. Closed on Thursday. The food pantry is open on Wednesday, 9 o'clock to 10:45. Rainbow Table is every Friday from noon to 1. Our reader today of the lessons will be Gina Pollock. Linda and Nelson Smith are our ushers.
As a called ordained minister of the Church of Christ and my authority, I bear therefore declare you the entire forgiveness of all your sins, in the name of the Father, and the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. We now begin our worship with the hymn, God of Our Fathers, which is printed on the back of your book. God of Our Fathers, printed on the very back.
Thank you.
consecrated in the prayer of the day as it was printed in the top of the today's reading insert in here. Let us pray. Almighty Creator and ever-living God, we worship your glory, eternal, free, and one,
and praise your power, majestic, one and three. Keep us steadfast in this faith, defend us from all adversity,
and bring us at last into your presence, where you live in endless joy and love, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. You may be seated as we listen to the reading of God's word.
Gina Pollock will be doing the
reading. Our reading from Isaiah. In the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord sitting on a throne, high and lofty, and the hem of his robe filled the temple. Seraphim were in attendance above him. Each had six wings. With two they covered their faces, and with two they covered their feet, and with two they flew. And one called to another and said, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. The whole world is full of his glory." The pivots on the threshold shook at the voice of those who called, and the house filled with smoke. And I said, "Woe is me. I am lost, for I am a man of unclean lips, and I live among a people of unclean lips. Yet my eyes have seen the King, the Lord of hosts." Then one of the seraphs flew to me, holding a live coal that had been taken from the altar with a pair of tongs. The seraph touched my mouth with it and said, "Now that this has touched your lips, your guilt has departed, and your sin is blotted out." Then I heard the voice of the Lord saying, "Whom shall I send, and who will go for us?" And I said, "Here am I, send me." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
If you live according to the flesh, you will die. But if you live by the Spirit, you put to death the deeds of the body, you will live. For all who are led by the Spirit of God are children of God. For you did not receive a spirit of slavery to fall back into fear, but you received a spirit of adoption. When we cry, Abba, Father, it is that very Spirit bearing witness with our spirit that we are children of God, and if children, then heirs, heirs of God and joint heirs with Christ, if in fact we suffer with him so that we may also be glorified with him. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
backyard barbecues? Is it opening up the family pool for the summer season? When we lived up in Northwest Indiana, our neighbor would work feverishly to have his pool open by Memorial Day each year. Of course, we lived about 5 miles from Lake Michigan. And every year for 8 years, we would watch as he and his family would sit around the pool in sweatshirts, looking at the water that was far too cold for them to enjoy on Memorial Day. It would usually be the middle of summer before they could get in. It would take the water that long to warm up. Or when you think of Memorial Day, you think about a trip to a state park or a nearby historical site. Or maybe Memorial Day conjures up images of going to the lake for boating and fishing, or going to the beach. For many, this is what Memorial Day has boiled down to, a day of family and fun. But that was not the original intent of Memorial Day. Memorial Day is supposed to be a time of memories and moments to recall. To think about it, those men and women who gave their lives, which were cut short by their service to their country, or their lives were severely altered because of the tremendous wounds they received in battle on behalf of our nation. So today and tomorrow we remember all of those men and women, and in some cases even youngsters, because almost in every war, up until maybe the wars in Iraq and Afghanistan, but through the revolution through Korea at least, there are those stories of young men, especially, in some cases women, who lied about their age so that they could join the conflict at 16, 17 years old. And so we remember them. Protestants and Catholics, Christians and Jews, Muslims and Hindus and Buddhists and all other types of religions. And as we gather today to remember them, we especially want to remember those brothers and sisters who made that ultimate sacrifice, who are our brothers and sisters in Christ Jesus. For we know that those brothers and sisters of ours in the faith who made that ultimate sacrifice are missed, but they are also blessed. Blessed because we have a promise. A promise that assures us of where they are now and what they are doing. Turn with me, if you have your Bible, to the 14th chapter of the book of Revelation. The last book of the Bible. So it's easy to find. Just turn with the back of your Bible. Open it up. Find Revelation. In that 14th chapter, that 13th verse, John continues his vision, and he says, "And I heard a voice from heaven saying, 'Write this, blessed are the dead who die in the Lord from now on. Blessed indeed,' says the Spirit, 'that they may rest from their labors, for their deeds follow them.'" Blessed are those who die in the Lord, for they may rest from their labors and their deeds follow them. What St. John is telling us by recording this vision is, first of all, that when a saint of God dies, which is anyone who believes in Jesus Christ, they enter rest. Blessed indeed that they may rest from their labors. That word blessed, in this case, it means sharing the life of God. It means to be happily following the right path, which is faith in Jesus Christ. So they are missed when they are blessed because having followed Jesus Christ in this life, they are now in the presence of God in his eternal kingdom at rest. The word die the church militant. When we pass away to eternal life, we call that the church triumphant. So those we miss who made that ultimate sacrifice are blessed because having died in faith in Christ, they now are in that eternal bliss. A little boy one day asked his mother, "What is death like? And does it hurt?" To which his mother responded, "Sid, do you remember when you were younger and when you would be afraid you'd like to crawl into your big brother's bed? And around midnight, big loving hands would pick you up and carry you back into your room and place you back in your own bed, so that when you woke up in the morning, you woke up in your own room. That is what death is like, waking up in your own room." And why would she say that? Because, if you recall, back in the Gospel of John, the same writer of the book of Revelation, Apostle John records for us in that 14th chapter, Jesus telling us that in his Father's house are many mansions, or as the modern translations translate it, many dwelling places or many rooms. So we have this promise that through faith in Jesus Christ, when we die, we have our own dwelling place in the kingdom of heaven. We have our own place that Jesus himself prepares for us. He doesn't pass the duty off to one of the archangels like Michael or Gabriel or Raphael. He doesn't pass the responsibility off to Peter or James or John or Andrew or Thomas or Paul or any of the apostles. I go and prepare a place for you, he says. I go, and I will come again to take you unto myself, so where I am, there you may be also. You know the way to the place where I am going. And Thomas said to him, "Lord, we do not know where you're going. How can we know the way?" And Jesus answers, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me." So those we now miss, those we remember, those we honor this weekend are blessed because they are in their own room, their own dwelling place, their own mansion in that kingdom of heaven prepared by Jesus himself. At death, those who gave the ultimate sacrifice for our nation find rest in that dwelling. But separation is painful. We miss someone we love who was taken from us in death. And it doesn't matter whether we're talking about someone in the military killed in war, or we're simply talking about someone we love who passes away due to illness or natural causes or an accident or whatever reason they leave the church militant for the church tribe. They are missed. Separation is painful. And we mourn their loss. My dad had an older brother, Austin, who he referred to as June. He was called June because he was named after their father, Austin, so he was a junior, just like I'm a junior to my dad. And his brother was about 2 years older, before the war, as the war broke out, joined the Marine Corps. And according to newspaper articles that my grandma had saved and given to my aunt and then gave to me, my uncle was the very first Marine to set foot on Guadalcanal Island, the very first island we invaded after Pearl Harbor. And he survived the conflict through August, September, and October. And then in November, he was sent out on what was supposed to be a routine patrol and the part of the island that was supposed to be pacified and the Army and Marines had taken control of. Well, as they were on patrol, they went past a certain area and suddenly out from the ground popped up a Japanese machine gun. And as the Japanese opened fire with the machine gun, they killed everybody but the point man. soon as he heard the machine gun, he dove behind a rock and began returning fire, and eventually killed and wiped out the Japanese machine guns. When the patrol did not report back to camp as scheduled, another patrol was sent out to find them, and my grandma told me that when they came upon what had happened, the young man who survived was sitting on that rock that he had used for cover. And he had taken my uncle and the other members of that patrol and put them in kind of a semicircle around him. And that he was sitting on that rock crying like a baby. Every time, once I grew old enough to recognize changes in my dad's voice, or able to read his face, or I felt something was changing about him. Whenever he would mention his brother June, and he would mention him often, he would often bring up stories about his brother. But every time he did, I could always see the mistiness in his eyes, and tears beginning to well up, and a softness to his voice. Even before he died, right before he died, he talked about his brother the same thing, because he always missed his big brother. He always missed what his big brother could have done had he survived the war. And so we miss those that we lose, but we also celebrate them and remember them because we know they are at rest. They know they are at a rest that we cannot really comprehend and understand. Even though John tries in the book of Revelation to explain what he has seen, even though Jesus in many of his parables describe or use those parables to give us a glimpse of heaven, we still cannot comprehend an existence without death and grief and crying and pain. We cannot comprehend an eternity because our minds are finite. Because we just cannot comprehend that, the idea of existing forever. But that is the promise we are given. And that is the promise we have. The word "may rest" means to be refreshed or rejuvenated. We rest from our labors. The word "labors" means troubles or difficulties. It's the picture of an exhausted soldier who has been in battle for so long. He's in dire need of rest and relaxation. It means to be fatigued. It means to be free of temptation and trials. It means to be comforted and relaxed. To be free from ever being tired again. That is the rest that the followers of Jesus Christ go into when they leave this world for the world eternal. We rest. Never completely rested and rejuvenated. No matter how much we try to make up sleep, no matter the vacations we take, whatever, we still are constantly doing something. But in heaven, we have a rest and rejuvenation that we never can experience here on earth. Maria Bruno. Young lady even lives in the town of Poignant, Germany. She was willing to go to jail to find rest. Her husband was unemployed, and so she supported the three children and her husband by cleaning other people's houses. Even without a job, her husband somehow managed to rack up $5,000 worth of unpaid parking tickets. She couldn't pay the fine. And if the husband did not come up with the money, then she was going to have to spend 3 months in jail because it was her name that was on the title of the vehicle, so she was responsible. And you would think she would have panicked at the idea of being in jail for 3 months, but she actually welcomed the thought. She said, quote, "I've had enough of scraping a living for the family. As long as I have food and a hot shower every day, I don't mind. them for a resident. And heaven is not Jacob. But the idea is that she, Maria, went to jail to find rest and relaxation from her hectic life. When we go to heaven, those we honor and celebrate this weekend who are already in heaven have this rest and relaxation like we cannot comprehend. A rest and relaxation where there are no more troubles, no more difficulties. They're not exhausted like a soldier needing rest and relaxation. They're not fatigued. They're free of temptation and trials. And how much does that take out of our life each day as we fight temptation and trials? They are there where they are comforted and relaxed and free from ever being there. So that is a wonderful thing about God's saints being at rest. They are missed, but they are blessed. One Christian writer has said, speaking of death, quote, "Death guarantees the sinner's penalty and the believer's promise." Death is where the words of Jesus come absolutely true with no appeal. And death, if we are a believer, we receive that promise of that place prepared for us by Jesus himself. If we refuse God's grace, then we risk ending up like the rich man in the parable of the rich man and Lazarus, being in that torment that never ends. And also what St. John is telling us in this verse from the 14th chapter of Revelation is that those who die in their Lord, in the Lord, their works follow them. Now, what does the Spirit mean by saying their works follow? Salvation is by grace through faith, apart from works of the law. But he's not talking about works of the law. He's not talking about trying to earn your way into salvation. He's not talking about trying to bargain with God for salvation by having done good things. He's talking about the deeds he's talking about are those things we do as a response to the love that God first showed us. As Jesus reminds us in the gospel lesson, God so loved the world that he gave. What did he give? His only Son. So that whoever believes in him should not perish but have everlasting life. God didn't have to give to us his Son. He could have sent down a new set of commands for us to follow, obey in order to try to have salvation. But instead, out of that great love, he sent his Son Jesus, who willingly suffered and died upon that cross, so that his blood could pay the debt of sin that we owe, and that by rising assures us of the gift of forgiveness and everlasting life. So our deeds are responding to that love that God first showed. It's not to earn granny points. It's not to earn heaven. That's our gift of grace through faith. These are those actions we do in response to God's love, fulfilling the command to love our neighbor as ourselves, and to love one another as he does love us. It is when we give that drink of cold water to someone who's thirsty. It is when we give food to that person who is hungry. It is when we give clothes to that person who is unclothed. It is visiting the sick and in prison. We do those as a response to what God first did for us. It shows us, or it shows to the world, our character. That's another meaning of that word follow, when it says our deeds or labors follow us. It's a word for meaning character. Our character comes through our faith in Jesus Christ. That character of responding in love to our neighbor. Being that little Christ unto our neighbor for others. Again, an anonymous Christian writer has said, quote, "You cannot decide when and where you will die, but you can decide how love of God that He first showed us through the giving of His Son, Jesus Christ. So these deeds, these acts, follow us, no matter how little they might be. One day, two men came into a restaurant to have lunch, and they sat down and they ordered their meal. The waitress brought it to them and then went away and went over by the serving station. And she noticed the two men praying out loud, giving thanks for their food. And so she walked up to him and said, "Excuse me," said, "but were you two just praying?" And the men said, "Yes, we were." She goes, "Well, are you pastors?" And they said, "No, we're not pastors, but we work for the same boss." They were lay evangelists. And she said, "Well, I used to be a Christian." And she said, "But when I became a teen, I lost interest and fallen away. But I have a girlfriend. She keeps bugging me. She wants me to go to a Bible study, but I doesn't have time to do it or motivation to do it." So the two men began to engage in conversation about faith in Jesus Christ. They got up and left. A couple of weeks later, they came back. And the same young lady waited on them. And she told them eagerly about her experience in Bible study. And she finally concluded by saying, "I'm back. Thanks, guys. I'm back. Thanks." Wouldn't you love to hear somebody say that to you? Somebody who's backslidden, who grew up in the church but fell away as a teen or as a young person for whatever reason. Or maybe they went through some kind of tragedy and didn't have the proper comfort and support, and so they fell away. That's a little deep. It's not great in the eyes of the world, but it's great in the eyes of God, because it's leading another lost person into the kingdom of heaven. And so these little deeds, these little things we do for Jesus, are great in His eyes. For again, this Christian writer says, quote, "The little things we do for Jesus now will be the great things in eternity." In the world. So we remember those men and women and those youngsters, 15, 16, 17, who joined our military and made that ultimate sacrifice to keep us free, to enable us to enjoy this freedom of religion, freedom to worship as we desire, to not have some state church that dictates to us how we must worship each week, what we must follow, but instead the freedom to worship according to our traditions, where we grew up, the influences of our area of the country. So we remember them and we thank them for that ultimate sacrifice. We remember them not just for their passing and that ultimate sacrifice, but we remember them because they are at rest in that eternal kingdom of heaven. And in that rest, those little things they did for Jesus followed them to that resting place. We remember and celebrate our fallen heroes because these words are absolutely true. Blessed are the dead who die in the Lord from now on. Amen. The peace of God which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus.
Amen. Amen.
Please turn to page 104 in the front of your worship book.
Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, a one being with the Father, through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit in the Virgin Mary, and became truly human. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father.
He will come again in glory
to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic Church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come.
Amen.
Let us pray for the whole people of God in Christ Jesus and for all people according to their needs. Our response today is, hear our prayer. O eternal and unchangeable God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, with angels and archangels we laud and magnify your holy name. Accept our praise this day for creating us, preserving us, redeeming us, and delivering us to your forgiveness and salvation. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Almighty God, you bless the earth to make it fruitful, bringing forth in abundance whatever is needed for the support of our lives. Prosper the work of farmers and all who labor to bring food to our table. Grant them seasonable weather, that they may plant and harvest the fruits of the earth in abundance, and proclaim your goodness with thanksgiving. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Lord of the nations, according to your will, calm the troubled areas of conflict among the nations. Remove the threats of terror and anarchy that plague our world. Defeat the plans of all those who would stir up violence and strife, and destroy the weapons of those who delight in war and bloodshed. Protect all military personnel as they work to achieve an end to worldly conflict. Sustain them in their time away from family, and guide them to serve with honesty and integrity. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Lord Jesus, you promise to be with us always. Visit those who are in any type of distress with the assurance that you abide with them even in their infirmities. We pray for those among us who are sick, homebound, or undergoing tests and treatment. In the midst of their illness and afflictions, strengthen their faith so that they may bear any hardship in patience and trust, until you grant them deliverance, peace, and healing. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
On this weekend, O Lord, when our nation remembers those who have given their lives to preserve the freedom we enjoy, we honor their sacrifice and beg you to ever guard and defend this country from every evil that would assault and destroy our soul life. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Dear Savior, in the sacrament of the altar you reveal your glory in and under bread and wine. Grant that we who approach your altar to eat and drink your body and blood this day, do so in repentance over sin and in joyful recognition of your presence. Strengthen our faith, increase our love and hope, and assure us a place at your heavenly table, where we will eat eternal manna and drink of the river of your pleasure forever and ever. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Father of infinite majesty, hear our prayers for the sake of your adorable, true, and only Son, Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
You may be seated.
It's time for our offering. Nelson and Linda Smith are the ushers. They will be passing the collection plate.
Let us pray. Bless me, O God, maker of all things. Through your goodness, you have blessed us with these gifts, ourselves, our time, and our possessions. Use us and what we have gathered in feeding the world with your love, through the one who gave himself for us, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. St. John practices an open communion for all those who are baptized and believe in Jesus Christ as a personal Lord and Savior. We believe his body will ever truly present as we gather at this table. In our communion age and own individual congregation, you're invited and encouraged to come forward with us this day as we have at the table of the Lord. We continue our celebration with a great thanksgiving on page 152 in the front of your worship. The Lord be with you. body of the Lord Jesus Christ and his precious blood strengthen and preserve you in true faith and the life eternal. Amen.
Amen.
Let us pray. O God, we give you thanks that you have set before us this feast, the body and blood of your Son. By your Spirit, strengthen us to serve all in need, and to give ourselves away as bread for the hungry. Through Christ, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Amen. Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, bless you now and forever.
Amen. Amen.
We conclude our worship with Holy, 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 hymn number 413 in the back of your worship. Hymn number 413.
Services have started now. The 8 o'clock service on Sundays is at the Melody Cruise Drive-In on East 40, east of Springfield.